Welcome everyone to the 22nd meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. The second item on our agenda is consideration of 3 negative instruments. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committees considered these 3 instruments at the meeting on the 7th of June 2022 and have made no recommendations in relation to them. So the first instrument is the Novel Foods Authorisations and Smoke Flavourings Modification of Other Authorisations Scotland Regulations 2022. This instrument implements a decision by the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport in relation to 5 novel foods, authorising 4 new novel foods for placement on the market in Scotland and 1 extension of use of an already authorised novel food. The instrument also authorises the transfer of authorisation holder for 5 smoke flavourings. No motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments in relation to this instrument? No. I propose, therefore, the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with that? No, we're in agreement. The second instrument is the National Health Service Optical Charges and Payments and General Ophthalmic Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022, and the purpose of this instrument is to increase NHS optical voucher values by 2% to support more patients with eye problems being safely managed within the community, to enable remote consultations and to deliver other miscellaneous changes. And no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments they want to make? No, we don't. I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No, we're in agreement. And the third instrument is the National Health Service Vocational Training for Dentists Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2022. These regulations make amendments to the National Health Service Vocational Training for General Dental Practice Scotland Regulations 2004 to A, change the employer of dentists undertaking vocational training from training practices to NHS Education for Scotland or NES, and B, continue an exemption from vocational training for dentists holding certain European diplomas. And no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments in relation to this instrument? Sandesh, you do.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, looking at the vocational training that's here and the fact that it's now going to be NES that pays rather than the individual employers, does this then mean that they are paying their pensions contributions? I assume it does. But also, does it now allow those dentists on vocational training to access NHS benefits, including the Cycle to Work scheme?
Okay. Well, we can write to the Minister and we can ask for clarification on that. Okay. Any other members got any comments they want to make? Right, I propose that therefore the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument and writes to the Minister on the points that Dr. Gahane has just raised. Any member disagree with this? No, we are agreed. Right, so now move on to the substantive item in our agenda, which is agenda item 3 on health inequalities. We're continuing our evidence taking on health inequalities, and this follows a series of informal engagement sessions which we undertook on the 20th and 23rd of May 2022 to help understand people's experience in relation to health inequalities. Very good sessions, very intensive sessions where we heard from people with lived experience. During the session today, this is our opportunity to examine some of the issues that we heard. We're all in different breakout rooms, so we should have a good spread of questions to ask the people in front of us today. We'll be able to sort of dig deeper into some of the things that we heard. So we've got 4 people with us on our panel to answer our questions and and to give us some more information. And I welcome to the committee Tony Groundwater from Families Outside, who's with us in person. And we've also got Richard Mead from Carers Scotland in person as well. And joining us online, we've got Karen Lewis from the Hub, from Dumfries and Galloway, and Sharon Wright from the University of Glasgow. And I believe that all four of you have a brief opening statement that you would like to make. So if I come to Tony first of all.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for inviting us along today to highlight some of the inequalities that face those that we support and represent. At Families Outside, we work solely on behalf of children and families affected by imprisonment. And the challenges families face when someone goes to prison are clearly considerable. Worry for the person in prison alone is enough to merit support, let alone the multiple challenges they face for their own health and well-being. Imprisonment of a household member is one of 10 adverse childhood experiences known to have long-term implications for health and well-being. And the research continues to support the links between imprisonment of a family member and poor physical and mental health for the family, an impact on health even greater than divorce or bereavement. And one of the inequalities facing our families is often that they aren't identified or supported to get the help that they need. Greater awareness around the needs of children and families affected by imprisonment across the board is required. And Families Outside published, in collaboration with partners, a framework for the support of families affected by the justice system. And this was updated just the end of last year and can be found on our website. There are just over 8,000 people in prison in Scotland in any given day, and each year around 18,000 people are released from prison. And it is estimated that around 27,000 children are affected, but that figure could be much more, as I mentioned earlier, in terms of the challenges we face, in terms of identification of children and families. But by that very fact that someone is imprisoned, it increases the health inequalities for them and their families. And we know that health inequalities are widespread amongst our prison population. Almost every health problem is overrepresented, including those with problem drug use and mental health problems. Prison should be viewed as a unique opportunity to address health inequalities. The potential benefits of engaging with people in prison and their families effectively around their health are immense. Now, however, people describe to us, and we heard through the informal sessions that Convener had mentioned, that the difficulty in terms of access to basic healthcare in prison, as well as significant problems in continuity of care upon release. In many cases, it has led to serious and traumatic consequences, all of which were felt to be avoidable if treatment and better joined-up approaches had been provided. We've heard instances of medication not being made available for people with existing conditions on arrival in prison, sometimes for a number of weeks. Hospital appointments missed due to shortage of staffing and escorts not available. We heard of someone also missing multiple visits to hospital in relation to a leg injury, which resulted in long-term disfigurement and ongoing problems. And we continually hear about the long waiting times to receive support. We would like to see parity in policy and practice between justice and health agencies and their involvement of families, and recognising families as carers with significant and valuable information and support to contribute. The Mental Welfare Commission report on prisons in April this year echoed this point, highlighting that the mental health of prisoners and families could be significantly improved with responsive communication protocols between mental health services, prisons and families, through which families can report their concerns. Now, we do recognise the ongoing challenges facing prison and healthcare staff, but what we've heard about the experiences of those we support and their families are unfortunately not isolated incidents or one-off failings in the system or practice. It chimes with much of what we can see in terms of the evidence available. From the Royal College of Nursing Scotland reports, prison inspection reports and independent prison monitoring all highlight clear themes around health centres that are not fit for purpose, long waiting lists, challenges around staffing and escort services, and barriers in communication and collaboration between prison and healthcare staff. Now, the transfer of healthcare from SPS to the NHS in 2011 was driven by the need to reduce health inequalities for those people in our prisons. But a review of the prison inspection reports into health and wellbeing in April 2021 concluded that whilst there is much to admire and transfer in the way health promotion is operationalised in Scottish prisons, it is apparent that this is not universal across our prison estate. And the rhetoric of health promotion in prisons seems to be ahead of the reality in practice. We want to see health and the health care of people in prison and their families at the forefront of the open political debate to reduce health inequalities. People we support often simply ask for compassionate responses, but instead what many get is a feeling of being stigmatised, excluded, and that they are guilty of a crime by association. There's an opportunity with joined up approaches between health and justice to reduce health inequalities for many across Scotland. And people in prison and their families cannot remain unseen and unheard in this context. Thank you.
I ask Richard Mead to speak on behalf of Carers Scotland.
Good morning. Thank you for having me along today. The idea that informal, unpaid caring should be considered a social determinant of health was first raised in the UK in a report for Public Health England published last year. And there is now a growing sort of weight of UK and international evidence that makes the case for recognising caring as a social determinant of health. The World Health Organization defines social determinants of health as the non-medical factors that influence health outcomes. They are the conditions in which we are born, grow, work, live and age, and the wider set of forces and systems shaping the conditions of daily life. A carer can be defined as someone who provides care to ill and disabled family members, friends, partners, or neighbours. They are unpaid, and they are often themselves family members, friends, partners, or people in the community. And they are usually described as unpaid or informal carers. The vast majority of the existing research shows that unpaid carers experience poorer quality of life, including mental and physical health outcomes, when compared directly to those who do not provide care. Carers experience higher levels of carer burden, depression, anxiety, distress, and stress. They are at greater risk of premature death and experience greater prevalence of disease, and this includes greater risk of muscle and bone conditions, heart disease, cognitive deterioration, and poor sleep. The Public Health England research suggested that compared to non-carers, carers were 16% more likely to be living with two or more health conditions, arthritis and high blood pressure being most common. And these poor health outcomes are likely to be exacerbated by social isolation, poor support, inadequate information, as well as the financial pressure often faced by carers. The higher the intensity of the caring provided, the poorer the outcomes. The longer a person has been a carer, the greater the impact on their physical health, which deteriorates over time at a greater and faster rate than those not caring. 14% of carers in Scotland currently provide more than 50 hours a week of care. Neglecting their own health is a common practice among carers. Carers are less likely than non-carers to own their own homes, less likely to be employed, and more likely to be in poverty. 7% of carers are forced to give up work in Scotland, and many and more are forced to reduce hours that they work. Supporting the mental and physical health and well-being of carers is essential and actually does make a difference. Carers who do have access to services have better health outcomes on average than those who do not. However, many carers struggle to access any support or statutory services, and many carers go unidentified for support at all. Carers are more likely to be women. 61% of carers are women, and they care on average more hours a week than male carers, meaning that unpaid care has a disproportionate impact by gender. The health inequity gap caused by caring has not been closed since the establishment of the Scottish Parliament, but is actually growing. The COVID pandemic has exacerbated much of these issues faced by carers and led to many experiencing poorer outcomes. During the pandemic, more people were providing care than ever before. We estimated around 1.1 million people in Scotland were providing care during the pandemic. And the number of people providing care has not returned to pre-pandemic levels. We know that over 70% of unpaid carers did not get a break or any respite during the pandemic. Many have failed to access services, both for themselves and those they care for, and they have struggled to get appointments for their own health concerns, exacerbating their health conditions further. And many are still shielding despite the lifting of protections, worried about the impact of COVID and the failure for local authorities and other services to return to pre-pandemic levels. All this is at the time when the same unpaid carer as a whole is contributing over $11 billion a year to the health and social care system. That health and social care system would quite simply collapse without unpaid carers. The growing level of unmet need for carers is likely to continue as more and more people need care, and there is a greater reliance on unpaid carers to meet the increasing gap in the provision of statutory services for ill and disabled people. And the emerging evidence shows that the difference in health outcomes between carers and non-carers, when accounting for all other factors, means you are at greater risk of ill health by being a carer. And that is why caring must be considered a social determinant of health. And this should be reflected in all national and local public health policy and strategies designed to tackle health inequalities. It should be a focus and a priority of Public Health Scotland. There is also a lack of research in unpaid care, its consequences, its complexities and interventions. Particularly in Scotland, much of that does exist comes from other parts of the UK or is international. A substantial research programme is definitely needed to better understand the complex nature of unpaid care and the adverse consequences that care can bring. Such a programme should look also to test new models of care and support for carers, reflecting that understanding of that complexity. We would love to see a research centre for carers established in Scotland. There also needs to be increased investment in those existing interventions to support carers, particularly breaks for caring, and financial support to ensure that carers do not fall into poverty and those that are in poverty can be lifted out of it. For example, we would love to see another doubling of carers' allowance supplement this December to help carers when their energy bills are likely to be at their highest and Christmas is on the horizon. The failed systematic support for carers has created a public health crisis. I would urge this committee to reflect on this in its conclusions to this inquiry and above all recognise and state that this Parliament sees caring as a social determinant of health and a public health priority for urgent action. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. And can I come to Karen Lewis from the Hub down in Dumfries and Galloway? Karen.
Many thanks for inviting me today. The Hub is a community anchor organisation in Dumfries and Galloway, and we deliver a range of social justice projects and services, one of which is the Regional Rent Deposit Guarantee Scheme, which is what I'm here to do a presentation about today. The Rent Deposit Guarantee Scheme assists people on low incomes in housing need access the private rented sector. We deal mainly with quite small scale landlords in Dumfries and Galloway. It's not a business model for them. It's one or two properties. They have jobs. Often many of them have only had a work-based pension recently, so it's often a pension asset for the future. So that's the majority of people we deal with. I think we can first say as a given that in terms of sort of health and well-being and any kind of social justice, that one of the basic needs in life is that you have a home that you feel secure in, that you feel you can put roots down, that you feel you can build a life. You also, another great determinant is that you've got self-agency. You can make active decisions and you have options about your life. And I think we'd all agree those are important building blocks of having good mental health and well-being. We need to challenge the assumption that everyone who faces homelessness or is homeless has got complex needs or a chaotic lifestyle. Certainly many households do, and there are, you know, support mechanisms, particularly perhaps the Housing First model where there's multi-agency approach works for them. But in our estimation of the people we work with in Dumfries and Galloway on the Rent Deposit Guarantee Scheme, it's quite simply poverty. They are poor. We are one of the lowest wage economies in Scotland, and we have a lot of people who are in work poor, who are underemployed and possibly on minimum wage rates. So I think we need to accept that and accept that we, not accept it, we need to challenge it, but accept that this is happening, that people are in housing need due to poverty. No other complex needs are involved. So rather than do a lot of statistics on the people we've supported, I thought I would present just a couple of case studies which demonstrate the inequalities people experience in health determinants and just in how the system works if you are poor, on a low income, and having to live in the private rented sector. So I thought I'd give an example. We're working with somebody called Sue at the moment. She's 30, unemployed, and she is in a private rented flat that she's obtained through the Rent Deposit Guarantee Scheme, because we've provided the deposit bond to the private sector landlord and a short-term rent and advance loan to enable her to access a home to live in. Her rent's £395 a calendar month. Now, the local housing allowance that is part of Universal Credit, we in Dumfries and Galloway have the lowest shared room rate local housing allowance in Scotland. So basically, she will be getting around £260 in her Universal Credit towards her rent of £395 a calendar month. You can replicate this for anybody under 35 who's on basic Universal Credit, has no other added benefits throughout Scotland. The local housing allowance shared room rate is throughout the Scotland, and obviously it's assessed on a local authority level about what that's set at. So she's got to make up a shortfall out of her personal Universal Credit of £76 a week. She has got to find £135.70 a month to actually maintain her home. Now, I put it to you that the level of stress and anxiety about these kind of issues really absolutely affect people's mental health and well-being, and actually undermine their capacity to build a life. They're constantly worrying about this all the time. So what kind of current support's available to help people like Sue in the private rented sector? If you compare, if Sue had been lucky and had got a social housing tenancy, and on average their rents for a one bedroom flat are around about £325 to £330 a calendar month, all her rent would have been met. That stress and anxiety is moved from that person at similar levels of poverty, that is removed from them, but not from those who are in the private rented sector. So what current support can Sue get? Well, she can, and we have done, apply for discretionary housing payment, and this will top up that shortfall. But here is the issue. This is, there's clues in the title, it's discretionary, it's not a given. The maximum you can get that is 12 months. Usually it's 6 months. So how can anybody relieve that stress and anxiety knowing that they're on some kind of temporary support and help them maintain their home? Discretionary housing payment is just a sticking plaster, and we really need to accept that and look at another solution, which I will come on to in a minute as one of my suggestions. The other thing I wanted to flag up, and you know, credit to the Scottish Government on this one, that there was the tenant support grant was issued to local authorities. And this was a short-term support grant to assist people who had got into rent arrears during the COVID pandemic. And it was for them and their landlords to apply to the local authority to get. Again, that would remove a lot of stress from somebody if that help was going to be available. Well, again, I can only talk about Dumfries and Galloway, but we had 352 applications to this fund in Dumfries and Galloway. How many were from the private rented sector? 55, of which only 13 were successful. I'll just say that again. So only 13 tenants in the private rented sector accessed this fund. 84% of it was taken by social housing landlords. And again, we asked the question of the landlords we worked with, you know, why wasn't there more of an uptake of it? And they came back to us and were saying that it was the bureaucracy and the hoops you had to go through to access the fund, and the lack of the detailed information they needed about their tenants and their tenants' lifestyle and income, which you needed to put in a collaborative application. So I would say, and we can't say there's a causation here, but I think there's a correlation here, is that social housing has paid full-time staff. They have housing officers. They know an awful lot of detailed information about their tenants. So it's hardly surprising that they can, you know, get a pathway through the hoops that are there to access these funds. But I think, you know, again, I'll come on to a possible solution for that. So we were asked to think of what we would think of as solutions to these issues. I think, first of all, I would urge the Scottish Government to use its powers that it now has to create its own welfare benefits, to maybe look at a permanent benefit that in effect negates the shared room rate. It makes up that shortfall for people in the private rented sector. The New Deal for Tenants strategy that's recently just finished its consultation thankfully does have a very detailed section on affordability. It looks like one of the recommendations is going to be, for the first time, we get really comprehensive, deep analysis of affordability in Scotland within the private rented sector and the potential of a rent cap. Now, I think with the rent cap potential, and that's based on the affordability, not a broad brushstroke, but in kind of a housing market breakdown, and also affordability on the round of rent and of income, that maybe there's something about dovetailing those two things that I suggested about a new benefit. The other side of the equation, I think, is to, and this may be a bit more challenging, would be to revisit the old tenant initiative schemes that used to be around that are now no longer in place, that would assist those people who are in permanent jobs, maybe modest incomes, have got a credit reference, who would like to maybe move into the owner-occupied sector, releasing very quickly a social housing for people who need them. Maybe that needs to be revisited, those incentives used to pay people's deposit and their legal costs of buying. Again, you know, maybe something to look at like that. And I think we also need to look at incentivising landlords in the private rented sector, particularly low scale ones, that, as I said, it's not an income generation for them. But maybe there's something about supporting them so they've got better access to these schemes that do come out, and increase the uptake of those. And my final point is that, you know, we can't wait for 2040. And yet again, another, you know, laudable target of more social housing. We had the same aim and target for 2020, which was never reached. We need to be creative and solution focused now. Otherwise, inequalities and the impacts on people's mental health and wellbeing in insecure housing is a social justice issue which will just continue. And even worse, I think, by not acknowledging this, that we're actually accepting this. And in fact, indeed, some of the support mechanisms we introduce are actually colluding and facilitating with these short-term schemes of support, that this continues. And I don't think any of us in a fair and just society should accept that's normal. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. And can I come for the final opening statement from Sharon Wright from the University of Glasgow? Sharon.
Thank you. My main point is that poverty drives health inequalities, and in order to tackle health inequalities, we must tackle poverty. We need to be honest about the fact that death rates in the poorest communities are increasing now, so health inequalities are definitely worsening. So what's the problem? In my field, my research is about the lived experiences of people who claim social security benefits. And what my research shows is that people are experiencing a lot of poverty and hardship, even destitution, whilst claiming social security benefits. The source of the problem is that the UK system that should be protecting people from poverty and preventing poverty is not operating effectively because of more than a decade of cuts and reforms. What those have done is operate as a large-scale disincentive strategy. So people who should be claiming support are being put off from claiming the support they need. For example, disabled people and people with mental health problems should be getting adequate incomes, but they are not. So often people who have medical evidence for ill health are not able to claim benefits like universal credit on the basis of ill health, and they are treated as if they are fully fit for work when actually they're not. So several reports and a lot of research show that universal credit, rather than alleviating poverty, is actually driving poverty. That's because universal credit is not generous enough in the rate that it's paid at. It doesn't give people the money they need to cover their basic survival needs, and because of quite frequent deductions. So about half of all universal credit recipients have deductions made to the amount of benefit that they get. So to begin with, it's an inadequate amount, and then it's cut down further because of deductions. So those deductions are for things like rent arrears and to repay the 5-week wait. Also repaying previous tax credits, for example, to HMRC. So a lot of money that's coming in is going straight out to repay existing debts. So the situation is that unprecedented cuts to UK social security for more than a decade are combined with welfare conditionality to push people towards work, even when that's not realistic for them. Behind that is the world's harshest sanctions regime, and that contributes to stigma, hardship, people needing to use food banks. In the worst extreme, our research showed that people rely on survival crime or survival sex, worsening domestic abuse and worsening physical and mental health because of the hardship. Recent research that we did in Glasgow showed that people claiming universal credit still have an enormous fear of sanctions, even though the statistical likelihood of being sanctioned is now less than it was in previous years. So the system that's meant to protect people is not functioning properly, and that also has detrimental impacts on those that Richard mentioned, who are unpaid carers. There's two actions that are required, just two small actions. Cuts to the value of UK benefits need to be reversed. So one of the biggest impacts is from the benefits freeze, which went on for several years and brought inadequate incomes even lower, so that people who are claiming benefits, including those in work, had fallen incomes relative to the rising cost of living. So what could be done about that is that the Scottish Parliament could lobby Westminster to increase the rate of universal credit. The second major issue with social security is conditionality, and that is very damaging because it also applies to the partners of claimants who may be carers, and it also applies to those who are claiming universal credit in work, so people who are in low-paid work and in part-time work. Now, that includes a set of older women who've received less attention. So, for example, women in their 60s who would have expected to be in retirement. There's a lot that can be done to improve the system. The Scottish Parliament's own powers could be used to increase the carers' allowance supplement and increase child's payment. What's needed in the long term, though, is a major programme of reform to build support for progressive taxation. It was clear in the Scottish Spending Review that there's just not enough money for the enormous void between the support that's needed and the support that's actually available. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all of you for those comprehensive statements. So comprehensive, in fact, that you've probably answered what I was going to lead off with, which was your main asks in policy areas. I want to quote our predecessor committee, in fact, a predecessor from the fourth parliament. And they did an inquiry into health inequalities in 2015. And one of the things that they said in the report, that health inequalities would not be reduced without action to reduce inequalities in every other policy area and across every portfolio. And of course, what we've just heard from Dr. Wright there is it's not just also the portfolios of the Scottish government, but the portfolios of the UK government as well have an impact on the health inequalities. And I was going to lead off and ask all of you for your main ask, but you've given us a suite of asks and touching on quite a lot of those portfolio areas. So I'm actually going to dig into some of what Tony talked about, because I was in the breakout room with some of the people that you support. And I've got my notes from that session. And I have to say that after listening to people you support and yourself, I was really quite taken aback by some of the things that those families are being put through. And one of the things that really struck me is that, I mean, you led off by talking about the health inequalities that the family members suffer, and you talked about the adverse childhood experiences. But every single person in that room, that breakout room, were concentrating on the health inequalities of their loved ones who were in prison. That was their main focus. Not themselves, not the impact that had on their family, although that was evident just in listening to them. But their main complaint was that the worry and anxiety that they had for the people, like partners, you know, siblings, friends who were in prison or custody were not getting access to their rights to healthcare. Therefore, that was having you can see that was having an effect on their own mental health. You mentioned in your statement that there should be parity between the justice system and the healthcare system. I want to talk about that change that there was in terms of the SPS being responsible for the healthcare of their prisoners, and the change that there was for the NHS was responsible. And one of the things that we heard was that the families were saying when they had concerns about the health or people getting access to medication for long-term conditions, that the SPS were saying, well, that's the NHS that's letting us down there. And then the NHS would be saying, well, we can't get access to that person because of the people running the prison. So there was almost a kind of, they didn't know who it was that was responsible. Can you give us a wee bit more information? Because obviously you deal with these things every day.
Yep, thank you. I think one of the main calls, and you're rightly stating that, convener, in relation to the basic right to health from what we hear in terms of the people we support is not happening across our Scottish prisons. And one of the key things, I mean, if you just take what happened in 2011 in the transfer as an example, what we did is we embedded a culture where there's a prison regime already operating, and we took healthcare into that regime, which created many practical barriers and many cultural barriers to making that effective. So what we see in the 2017 Health and Sport Committee report, they stated things around, practical things around, a need for improved IT systems in relation to prescribing, for example. So those practical elements that really create massive barriers for people to be able to get access to, for example, medication just early, and that continuity of care when they go back out into the community. So these practical things in terms of how both systems operate, we don't think have been fully thought through and fully implemented to the greatest degree. So the prison regime and the healthcare, they create some massive barriers, and we would like to see much more joined up strategies to try and to improve health outcomes for people in prison and their families.
Another thing that was mentioned was the training of prison officers in identifying when somebody really did need healthcare as well. Could you give us a little bit more information on those, give us some examples of where that has fallen down?
Absolutely. I think, one of the prevailing things that we hear about a lot is the stigma and discrimination. So people coming forward to try and access much needed help and support, but not being able to either be taken seriously or to be forwarded on in terms of the specialist care that they might need. So again, you know, the basic right to health is not being met. So the escort service, for example, people needing to go to hospital for specialist care and then being told at the last minute that they weren't able to make a hospital appointment because that service is not available due to the structural challenges that are faced in terms of the staffing. We know staffing in terms of recruitment and retention of healthcare staff within prisons remains an ongoing problem. So there's some structural challenges in terms of on the ground that mean that people aren't getting access to the right care and support. And just to continue with that, we work with a family member who unfortunately lost somebody in prison due to death. And part of the fatal accident inquiry highlighted really a clear recommendation around staff training so that people working within prisons were prepared for some of the circumstances that they may be faced with. But also very simple things in terms of the administering of medical equipment, the logging of medical equipment within prisons, and people being able to be trained appropriately to be able to operate the much needed medical equipment should an emergency occur. And unfortunately in that instance led to a death in custody.
And just before I hand over to my colleague, bringing it to the other side, to the families, notwithstanding the considerable anxiety they have about their loved ones in prison and the impacts, I'm quite near to prison HMP Grampian, my constituency, and I've visited there. They have a family centre which provides a lot of support to the families, which is not run by the SPS, is voluntary led. Is that the case across Scotland? Because it strikes me that is an opportunity. You mentioned that prison and that time in prison an opportunity to get help to those families. And these family centres, certainly the one that I've visited, seems to be a way of getting a lot of care and wraparound support to those families when they come to visit their family members inside. Is that the case across Scotland? Do they all have family centres, or is it very patchy?
Yeah, so there's 12 visitor centres across Scotland attached to each of the prisons, and that's an opportunity where family members who are visiting someone in prison can go. They can prepare for a visit. Children and young people can find out a bit more information about what a visit may look like. And that's an opportunity for health promotion and to tackle some of the health inequalities that we know are facing many of the families that we support. But still, we know that there's patchy and there's still work to be done in relation to the relationships between families and the SPS. So the communication and the involvement of families remains often a barrier. So we know that families can get involved in Talk to Me strategy groups and ICM, so integrated case management stuff, to support the family members. However, that still remains an ongoing challenge. There's many barriers in terms of how that some of those meetings are maybe made at the last minute, so family members travelling a long way can't get involved. And we would like to see an increase in terms of the digital aspect of that as well. But again, many of our families experiencing digital exclusion as well. So there is an opportunity there. However, we don't feel that it's joined up with the prisons enough to really fully kind of exploit that opportunity.
Okay, thank you very much. Sandesh, I'll bring you in.
Thank you, convener. It was just, Tony, about the quest, the statement you made just there about wanting an IT system for prescribing. As a GP, I see people who come out of prison because they need healthcare when they come out. I don't know what diagnoses have been made in prison, and you spoke in your opening statement about mental health issues. A lot of that comes to the fore in prison, where they're in a situation where they're viewed and seen and the mental health is diagnosed. So I don't know what the diagnosis is. I don't know what drugs they've been prescribed. So they come to me asking for drugs that ordinarily I don't prescribe because it's a specialist that prescribes them. And we're in this situation where it's completely unsatisfactory for the patient, but also for me, because I simply don't know what to do. We want an IT system that works, that talks to each other. We want digital prescribing. But my question is, what are your wants and asks to make the process of a prisoner coming out of prison accessing healthcare better for not only the patient but also for the healthcare professional? And invariably, they're the same thing.
Yep. Absolutely, thank you. I think the point you make is a really important one in terms of, I mentioned in my opening statement about continuity of care, and we know that often people are most at risk as soon as they leave prison, because often some of those wraparound supports are lost. And we would like to see much more widespread involvement around the through care approach. We know that in some areas that's been very successful. You know, someone having that support at the gate to be able to support someone to access much needed supports. And some of our other speakers today have highlighted the importance of housing. So we know there are barriers in terms of someone being able to register with a GP or be able to get the much needed medication that they need upon return to the community if they simply do not have an address. So joined up approaches need to happen to make sure that people do get access to some of those much needed health supports, particularly at which we know is a very risky time when upon leaving prison.
Thank you. Paul, can I bring you in?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel, and thank you for your presentations, which were indeed very informative. And I think all of the evidence we've heard in an informal session as well was very useful and very insightful as well. I suppose I'm keen to talk a wee bit about culture within our public services and the culture of how service delivery takes place. In one of some of the evidence given by the group from the Hub in Dumfries and Galloway, someone who was contributing said that there are judgmental and uncompassionate public services and described them as punitive rather than supportive. I think obviously we could see direct links to some of what Dr. Sharon Wright was talking about, I think, within the social security system more widely. But I wonder if that is also some people's experience of the variety of other public services that exist, whether that be in NHS, whether that be from local authorities in terms of provision of housing. That is quite stark when people are describing, I suppose, the network of support that we would all want to see there to kind of help people, actually perhaps doing the opposite and feeling judgmental. So I'm just keen to understand, how do we begin to shift that culture? I think we have had undertakings in terms of what the Scottish Government are trying to do through Social Security Scotland. I think we have undertakings in our local government sphere, but I'm keen to understand perhaps what more can we do to have a culture shift away from that sort of experience, essentially. So given that it came from the Hub, I don't know if we want to maybe start with Karen on that.
In our experience of people who are sort of navigating their way through statutory services, it's a very mixed bag. I think some services are very person-centred and have an ability to be flexible and go a bit beyond what's required. Like if the computer says no, they're coming up with, well, let me signpost you, let me set up an appointment with someone that may be able to help you. Other experiences people get, certainly approaching homelessness services, is very mixed. And I think it is a cultural thing as well. And I wonder sometimes whether, not making an excuse for it, but I think sometimes when you work at the coalface and you're dealing with a very inflexible system, you've got to deliver. Maybe you internally close down a wee bit because you're protecting your own self, because you know what you're saying isn't what the person wants to hear. It's a very difficult conversation to have. And I think there is something about empathy, boundaries, about wanting to actually assist people. That's a kind of personal kind of value base. And maybe some people have to switch that side of their personality off to even cope with the crisis they're dealing with every single day of their working life with people in need. We don't do, unless you're working in that field, you wouldn't know what that's like. But certainly I think that some of the homeless presentations, the loopholes you've got to go through, the kind of lack of forward sending people on where they might be helped, that's where there's a disconnect. And again, it goes back to what other people have said about continuity of care. It's almost like continuity. If you've come to me, I have a responsibility to give you an exit to somewhere that may be able to help you, rather than just saying we can't.
Would anyone else like to come in? I guess that whole issue of the no wrong door, I think one of the people said in submissions that, you know, it takes a lot for somebody to go and ask for help in the first place. So wherever they go and ask for help should be a gateway to that help. Richard, I see you nodding.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think just on that particularly, lots of unpaid carers go unrecognised and unidentified and don't get the support they need as a result. And that recognition can come in two parts. Firstly, carers themselves don't necessarily see themselves as carers. They might just see themselves as a wife, a husband, a father, a son, and so don't realise that they're a carer and don't realise that they themselves will be entitled to help and support. And equally, we find that a lot in statutory services, carers will go unidentified by practitioners who potentially could identify them. Whether that's in primary care, in social care services, the carer often is the person that they don't see. They'll just focus on the person that's receiving help and support, and the carer's needs will go unmet. So that recognition is hugely important for carers. And that, in terms of a culture shift, in terms of public services, I think absolutely that carers need to be seen, they need to be valued, and need to be recognised, and they need to be treated as partners in care and decision making. And they have a great deal of expertise and understanding, not only of the things that are surrounding them, but of the person that they're looking after. But often that for them, they feel frustrated because they feel isolated from decision making. They feel isolated from the practices that put in place to support the person they're caring for, and they don't feel empowered to be part of that decision-making process. So that's something we would like to see, a recognition and value of carers and the role that they play, and a real focus on identifying carers.
Mm. Could I bring in Sharon, wanted to come in? Just unmute.
Thanks.
Sharon's microphone.
Yeah,
Thank you.
That issue of the culture of service delivery is incredibly important, so thank you for raising that. And the trouble is in Scotland that a lot of the systems, well, certainly in relation to social security and a lot of housing-related issues, are controlled by Westminster, so the system is punitive. So when Karen was talking about housing insecurity within universal credit, it's the universal credit system that's creating something that's very cruel and punitive when people are trying to access housing and don't have enough money. And a lot of people that I've spoken to about claiming benefits have been very scared of losing their home. And there's other research from a colleague of mine, Ian Hardy, at University of Glasgow, that does show a statistical correlation between universal credit and housing insecurity. So it's that UK system that's operating throughout Scotland that is creating something that's cruel. And then the people on the ground, the support workers who are trying to help people, have to deliver some very unwelcome news. And they have to have that interaction that is based on a system that's really very unfair. So that takes its toll in terms of emotional labour from the frontline workers as well. And one of my recent studies, we spoke to work coaches at job centres in Glasgow, and they found that incredibly difficult sometimes, having to tell people, for example, EU migrant workers, when they were not eligible for access and universal credit. They found it really painful and really upsetting to have that conversation with people. Similarly, with a lot of people with mental health problems and physical health problems, when they still had to, the system required them to look for work, even though their medical records, they're getting medication, for example, for really severe mental health services, mental health problems, but the system still requires them to look for work full time. But I think that's another dimension of the cruelty of the system, that the frontline workers are actually stuck in that position, caught in the middle between a system that's not right and people's immediate needs. And I think we need to be honest as well about the Scottish system. So the Scottish Social Security system has deliberately taken a different alternative approach to offer dignity, fairness and respect. But we also need to acknowledge that the carers allowance supplement was set at the level of job seekers allowance. So in that sense, it mimics the UK system. It's sort of anchored in the UK system, and that doesn't offer people enough money to meet their basic needs. So in our Scottish benefit payments, we could make a different choice, and we could choose to make sure that those are tied to minimum income standards that actually ensure people have enough money to live on.
Thank you, Paul. Do you want to pick up on any of that?
No, I think perhaps just briefly, mental health. You know, I think in both answers we've alluded to the challenges that exist for people that are multiple and diverse. And I suppose I'm keen to understand if people feel that frontline workers who are supporting people have enough training in terms of understanding mental health issues, and I think particularly trying to identify and triage someone. Again, coming back to that no front, no wrong door approach, and trying to take a holistic view of a person and meet them essentially where they are when they interact with services. I mean, I think we've done some of that, but I'm not sure we've done quite enough. And I I'm just keen to get people's sense of we do need to do more and how we might do that across the piece.
Thank you. The first point I wanted to make was around, in order to create an effective culture, we must ensure that it's resourced appropriately, so that some of the other points that was made around, you know, severe pressures on the ground. But to pick up on Paul's point around training, the National Prison Care Network is developing some training for an induction for healthcare staff who work in prisons to better equip them. And for me, it strikes me that the most important part of any induction or training to feed into the culture that we want to see has to really involve those experiences and those lived experiences of people and the impacts of the systems and the policies that we create. What is the impact that that does have on people individually? So any training that we create must have that flavour, but also any, you know, any more inquiries and any more, we must continue to work with people with experience, not only to highlight some of the issues, but also to help us develop some of the solutions. And the final point around culture is around the right to health and ensuring that we make a shift in terms of all our minds around people have a right to health, and it's not a nice to have. So we need to continue to keep that, the rights-based approach, at the forefront of our minds.
Thank you, Tony. Can I come to Sharon? Just unmute Sharon, that would be lovely. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I think it's absolutely right that there's a huge need for more mental health training. But when we interviewed work coaches about that, work coaches at job centres, they felt frustrated as well. So the general support for them is sort of mindfulness or meditation. But if you've got to tell someone who's disabled or has really bad mental health problems that they're not eligible for benefits, or they have to repay money that they don't have, or that they have to go to a food bank because they've not got enough money, it's like a little bit of mindfulness doesn't really help you. You're going to feel really awful about that, and that's driving mental health problems amongst frontline workers as well as driving mental health problems amongst claimants. So I think that the big issues need to be resolved at the systemic level to stop the social security system creating and worsening mental health problems, as well as encouraging better training for frontline workers, because those people who are working in job centres, they did have some mental health training, not very much. It could definitely be better, and I think during COVID as well, we also know we've seen that mental health has worsened for workers as well as for people who are out of work. So the mental health challenge is enormous, and it's something that needs a lot of attention.
And can I bring Karen back in, please?
Yeah, I just make two quick points. Obviously, like other people who may be here today, I work in the third sector, And I think one of the things I would say is that if we're looking at practical solutions in terms of cultural shift and in terms of wider training, then I think there should be something when statutory agencies are involved that they see the third sector as meaningful partners. There'll often be a talk about partnership working, but that's not cascading training to third sector organisations that deliver activities that progress objectives of the statutory agencies. They're often seen more of this transactional group sector that's just going to carry out some activities. They're not involved in planning. They're not offered the training potential either. So that was my first point. And my second point would be, I think it's really important that every time I look at a policy paper or an operational plan that's going to put a policy into action, say from the health board or from the local authority, there's always impact assessments at the end of these. Maybe we should look at requiring that as part of the impact assessment, there's something about mental health and wellbeing. There's something about rurality. There's something about poverty as part of that overall impact assessment, so that there's no policy or operationalised policy that has got unintended consequences of those who have to live the life. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Emma, you have some questions for our guests.
Yep, thanks, convener. Good morning, everybody, and good morning to Sharon and Karen online as well. Probably a lot of questions have been answered already, but I was struck by, Sharon, your statement about basically poverty is the cause of health inequality and that universal credit doesn't work. And you know, the £20 uplift was removed, which was provided during COVID. And so that's £80 a month for people. So, but you're using really strong language like punitive, cruel, unfair. And even that is kind of demoralising, I'm sure, for lots of people to hear. So that was just a comment, actually, but I'd be welcome any further thoughts about what we need to do to change that, like minimum income guarantee, universal basic income. What kind of what do we need to do to progress that, as we've witnessed in other countries? And then my other question is for Karen, just about locally. I mean, I visited the hub a couple of weeks ago and I witnessed for myself the work that is being done in the hub. And I think, Karen, you should be commended, and you certainly like helped my knowledge. But you, the detail of the barriers for people applying for whatever support they can get, I'd appreciate a further expansion on that. Thank you, convener.
Come to Sharon first of all. I think your microphone is live.
Okay, Sharon? Can you hear me?
We can hear you perfectly.
Oh, good. Okay, I just said I was muted. yes, you're absolutely right. Universal credit is a major issue. So a £20 uplift would be extremely welcome. It is important that that would also apply to the legacy benefits, because one of the hard things for the £20 uplift, when it did happen, it was beneficial to those who were claiming universal credit, but for those who were on other benefits like employment support allowance or job seekers allowance, who hadn't moved over yet, it felt very unfair that they couldn't have the uplift. And obviously it was a terrible decision to remove it. It still was problematic in some respects, though, because during the COVID pandemic, when the uplift was in place, some people didn't get the full benefit of it. So you'd think if you give a £20 uplift, people will have £20 more in their pocket. But because there's so many deductions to universal credit, what actually happened was that for some of those people, they were paying out some of that money to repay old debts. So old debts like rent arrears or repayment to DWP. DWP are actually a very aggressive, have aggressive debt management strategies, sometimes requiring people to repay large sums within a very short period of time, or just having this regular deduction all the time, which leaves people with very little money to live on. In the long term, the minimum income guarantee that the Scottish Parliament's currently looking at is promising. But I think it depends on a number of different scenarios. So the minimum income guarantee could be most effective if the Scottish Parliament gets increased powers over Social Security. So that's most likely if there was a vote for independence, but that's not guaranteed. So if the minimum income guarantee was operating only with current powers or only with a partially increased set of powers over Social Security, it could be quite limited. So it could be that the minimum income guarantee would operate alongside the universal credit system. So I think there's, I have two concerns of that. First of all, that it might take a long time to get going, so maybe 4 years at least, maybe more. The second concern is that it might have to operate alongside major parts of the existing system like universal credit. So I would really urge you not to wait with your recommendations, but to just press ahead and ask for increases straight away, because people are really struggling. A lot of people are have very, very low incomes, and you can see that that is so much worse now than a decade ago, before we had universal credit, before we had the benefits freeze, before we had the 5 week wait and all these deductions. So the minimum income guarantee is hopeful for the future, but I don't think we can wait for that to take action, because what's going to happen while we're waiting is that health inequalities are going to worsen, and literally people in poorer communities will be dying while we're waiting for that to come in. So please don't delay with increases for income.
Sharon, can I just pick up on something? The Scottish Government seem to be prioritising families with children and getting money to families with children with the doubling of the child payment. But obviously that's going to miss out a lot of people as well. So there's other interventions.
Yes.
But do you think that prioritisation is probably right at this time, or...?
It's really hard, isn't it? It's really hard to say that some people deserve money more than other people. I can see, well, it definitely will help with meeting the child poverty target. So it's a really good intervention to give more money to children. So I'm definitely supportive of increasing the child payment. It could easily double. That would be a really good use of resources. But like you say, that's really difficult for people who don't have children, because at least if the child payment comes in, the household has more money. But if there are no children in the household, then they're just left out of that transfer. And I think that really is an issue for households where there aren't any children, that increased likelihood of poverty and that deepening of poverty. And as time goes on, it gets worse and worse, because with universal credit, because that's for people in work as well, you know, it's replacing working tax credit. It's like there's no escape. So, and also those people who are most disadvantaged are, it's like a double disadvantage. You know, if you're disadvantaged in the labour market, for example, if you're a woman or a black or minority ethnic group, if you're disabled, there are employment penalties that mean that you're less likely to be in a well-paid job, you're less likely to progress in work, you're more likely to have low pay, you're more likely to be working part-time, and you're more likely to have to claim in-work universal credit, which will then sort of trap you into that poverty. So it's a genuinely really tricky issue. But going forwards, it's projected that 70% of working universal credit claimants will be women. And then within universal credit, the emphasis is on full-time work of 35 hours per week. And that's really difficult for many women who have caring responsibilities, either for children or for other adults, and women who also have health problems themselves and are disabled. So it's really difficult to find an easy solution, but I'm certainly supportive of an increased child payment.
Thank you. Can I bring in Karen, and then I'll come to other colleagues?
Yes, the question that Emma posited was about barriers faced by people, but I'd firstly just endorse a bit what Sharon said, is that, you know, the child payment will help those families with children, obviously, but the people we deal with, many of them don't have children or older people. I mean, we have people who we deal with on the rent deposit guarantee scheme who are, you know, in midlife, no dependent children, so it doesn't help them. So the barriers that we've found that affect people claiming support and help while they're in the private rented sector. So if we take that tenant support grants I referred to, where there were so few private sector tenants accessed it, you had to demonstrate that you had, obviously had to prove there was a rent debt. So that meant that the landlord had to show that they'd not had payments from the tenant. The tenant had to agree with that and had to show and explain why they hadn't paid their rent. Now, a lot of those tenants might have been getting some help towards the rent, not full housing allowance. They may be in work and getting some and had not paid it over. So the chances of them thinking they had a positive relationship with their landlord, they were frightened of collaborating to claim this. So that was one issue. But they then also had to look like they'd been a prepayment plan agreed between the landlord and the tenant. Difficult to prove you've got that, you've had that, you've developed that. So these were the kind of things that put off, I think, private sector landlords applying for it or being eligible for it, and tenants as well. Housing associations have already got all that paperwork. They have a kind of debt management process. They've already got these things ready to go with to claim. So that was one barrier. In terms of barriers faced by people just trying to access other kinds of help, we mentioned universal credit. You could have somebody 30 years old, working 32 hours a week. As I said, a lot of people in D&G are underemployed. If they're earning the minimum wage, they wouldn't qualify for universal credit. You know, if your take-home pay is around about £1,100 a month, you won't get any help whatsoever, not even council tax benefit, apart from the 25% discount. So after you've took off your rent of, say, £475 and your cost to travel to and from work, you've probably got £470 a month to live on. And that's somebody in work that can't get help from anywhere else. So I think, you know, again, the differential is going to grow with that because, you know, unless that person manages to work their way out of poverty, you know, get a better paid job or work more hours, that they're always going to be in chronic poverty. But the other thing that I wanted to just mention was a lot of people, and I think we lose sight of this, when you are struggling on very low income in poverty with all the impacts we've talked about on health, your worldview shrinks to just getting through that day. Your capacity diminishes to actually chase, to get through the gateways, to get through the barriers, to have the evidence to provide. So often people just give up. The system grinds them down. And I think sometimes we have the support there, but the processes people have to go through to access it mitigates against the very people who are vulnerable and who have got a lot of other stress factors going on in their life to even cope with waiting on the... I mean, an example, I tried to ring up the benefits section yesterday for someone. I was on the phone 55 minutes before it then cut off because the office had closed. I was trying from just before 5 to 4 till 5 o'clock. Now, that's me as a worker using my work phone. I'm paid to do that time. But if I was somebody under stress, I'd just give up. It would just be defeating. And I think we have to realise we need to look at simplifying access to things and having decently funded support services that assist people navigate the way through these things. Because without that, that is why there's undertake on support and benefits. And that is why it seems to be the people with the highest capacity who maybe get them than others. And that builds inequality within a group of people that already are facing inequality. There's different layers of it, which I just don't think in a social justice sense is acceptable. Thank you.
Richard, can I bring you in?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to obviously pick up the issue of unpaid carers. A report by the Joseph Rowntie Foundation published this year found that unpaid carers are more likely to be in poverty than carers, than non-carers. And actually, the greater the number of hours that a carer works, the more likely they are to be in poverty. And although, and actually we published a report earlier this year too, looking at carers and the cost of living crisis, and overwhelmingly carers are facing greater increases in everything from energy bills and reduced income. And obviously we do welcome the carers allowance supplement, but even with the carers allowance supplement, that is simply not enough to meet all the challenges. And carers allowance, as we know, as soon as you hit, if you're a are working as a carer, as soon as you hit £132, you lose any entitlement to that. And if you're of a pensionable age and you're receiving any kind of pension, then you also won't get carer's allowance. So I think carer's allowance in Scotland only reaches about 90,000 carers. So lots of carers really struggle, and we need to do a lot more through Scotland's social security system, and hopefully through the carers assistance consultation there's a chance to do that, although I have some doubts. We need to do much more to address what is really carer poverty. And I know the Scottish Government has a child poverty strategy. We would very much be in favour of a carer poverty strategy too, to try and address some of the unique conditions that carers face and the poverty that they face, and how we might address that through the powers we have in Scottish Parliament.
Now, obviously, the increase in utility bills, particularly from heat and electricity, that's really going to be affecting people with care and responsibilities.
Absolutely.
Disproportionately.
Massively disproportionately. I mean, I can give you some really good examples of people. Often, if you're caring for somebody that has medical equipment in the house that might need to be on 24/7, you simply cannot turn that off. So how are you going to be able to then meet those costs? And we've seen examples of carers facing bills in the tens of thousands a month because of costs. Now, that's extreme, but that's not uncommon that carers are facing, or families with people with disabilities and carers are facing, huge challenges to heat their homes, to keep their homes running on such very limited financial resources.
Yeah, so carers allowance comes in, but gets completely swallowed up by an increase in,
totally.
In fuel bills.
Doesn't even touch the sides.
But yeah. Emma, you have a very short supplementary question, and I must move on to other members who are starting to come in with asks.
Sure. Thanks. It is a very short question for Karen. The rent deposit guarantee scheme, is it only a Dumfries and Galloway hub thing, or is there other third sector D&G hub equivalents that have it as well in Scotland?
There are rent deposit guarantee schemes across Scotland. Majority of them are statutorily run. There are about two or three nearest ones in Ayrshire that runs it. So, but each of them run in different ways. For instance, our scheme, we're not allowed through our funding agreement to cover rent arrears. So basically, we're saying in Dumfries and Galloway, putting all the risk on the landlord, who has a social conscience, who will take the rent deposit instead of a cash deposit, and they're going to run the risk of the if this rent arrears, which they would normally have been able to keep a deposit for. So they do run in throughout Scotland. They're funded in different ways. They're not centrally funded. And we're supported by Crisis, who supports the rent deposit schemes in Scotland. They were funded to do that. They've not anymore, but they still do it. I don't know off the top of my head, but I can let you know how many there are.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. Colleagues, I'm just letting you know, we're going to extend the session for another 15 minutes, so we've got until 11:30, but there's an awful lot of you now wanting to ask questions, so I wonder if you can direct them to individuals. That means we'll get through everyone. David, you have a question or two.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the witnesses. The third sector is very successful in reaching families, individuals and communities, and in many cases far better than government agencies. How has the COVID pandemic affected the third sector? And I'm talking about volunteers here because they rely heavily on it. And I just know two of the organisations that I've been involved in, they just haven't returned in the same numbers. So maybe Richard first.
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of unpaid carers, certainly what I can tell you about COVID and is that actually for many unpaid carers, COVID simply isn't over, and many are actually still acting as if we were during the lockdown. They're shielding, they are deeply concerned about COVID coming into their household, whether they get it themselves, which means they can no longer provide care potentially to the person they're looking after, or worse, that it gets to the person they're looking after. And if that person is clinically vulnerable, then there's a risk of severe outcomes, and they have deep concerns about that. So for many unpaid carers and people that we work with, they are acting as if they are continuing to shield and feel a bit isolated, actually, from society's return, in a sense, to normal as protections have been lifted. So, yeah, we've definitely seen a lot less interaction from people that we might have seen prior to the pandemic.
Anyone else wants to come in on David's question? Maybe Karen, it might be appropriate to what's happening in the hub?
Yes, there's definitely been an impact on volunteering. I think people over COVID internalised that kind of isolation. And I think that's going to be a transition for people to feel they can come back and volunteer again. And I think a lot of the changes that were brought in during COVID in how we delivered and how we engage with volunteers shifted maybe part of the role, which again is maybe some people are learning a new role, or but there's definitely been an impact, and I think it will come back, but I think it'll take time, and I think it needs, you know, to be recognised that, because an awful lot of statutory agencies rely on the third sector and volunteering to deliver activities and services. And I think there needs to be a recognition that that's a challenge. Many third sector organisations don't have funding to employ a volunteer development post. I know certainly at the Hub we've revisited all that because of to maintain our volunteering and to provide additional support they may need during this transition period.
Thank you. Quickly, David.
One quick question, convener. Many people I represent are in poverty, but they're in work. And the question's to Sharon, actually. Sharon, what do we need to do to change employment law? Because a lot of them are on zero-hour contracts and things like that are forcing them into poverty. And they're stuck because they cannot then go into benefits.
I think that's a really tricky question. So the living wage definitely does help in promoting the living wage, or even requiring the living wage would be helpful. In terms of change in employment law, I think it's quite tricky because of limitations in Scottish jurisdiction. Zero hours contracts are problematic. So people who are on universal credit can be required to take 0 hours contract jobs that don't offer any particular hours, but sort of tie people into a contract. In terms of getting rid of it, I'm not exactly sure how you would do it, but I do like the intention.
Can I come to Tess?
Yes, thank you, convener. A question for Tony and Richard, if I may. There is a Scottish Government target for 250 link workers in surgeries. So go to Tony first, but people coming out of prisons, integrating into the community, and they need healthcare. Do you think that having the link workers in the surgeries would help?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the key point for me, and I mentioned it earlier, is around the through care element. So engaging with someone whilst they're in prison and setting up some of those key services and supports that they may need. So I think that so long as that's the continuity is maintained and the relationship that we know is really, really important for that consistency to happen in a community, I think so long as that's going on, then we would be really supportive of that. But I think that's the key element, is that the relationship started and maintained while someone's in prison.
Thank you. So yes, and Richard, the link workers in surgeries?
Yeah, I think, well, actually, I think everybody in health and social care settings should really have a duty to try and identify carers. And actually, link workers are a really important part of that. GPs themselves, it could be practice nurses, it could be the staff that are working reception desks. Carers often come in accompanying the person they're looking after, but might sit in the waiting room and nobody speaks to them, nobody identifies them, they could be caring and they could be identified at that point. So I think absolutely health and social care staff should have a duty to identify carers, and link workers could definitely be part of that.
Great. So a message could be to speed up the recruitment of those 250 link workers. Can I ask another question, which is a general question to the panel? So the pandemic has exacerbated systemic health inequalities. In your own areas, have each of you identified one example of good practice, even if it's a small example, that could be widened across Scotland? So if we started with Richard.
To be honest, I think there are lots of little things that perhaps have made some improvements. And I think actually some of the digital stuff that we've seen, so the ability for people to access digital services. But the problem that, of course, is the digital exclusion. I talked about, obviously, a lot of families are still continuing to shield and worried about coming back out into society.
Sorry, that's like a bigger issue. Is there one tiny, small example of best practice that you've identified that could be...
Digital. Digital, whether that's using hybrid for work, whether it's support with appointments for GPs, all of the digital benefits that we've discovered during the pandemic can definitely play a role.
Okay. Thank you. Tony?
I think it relates to both your points there, but I think one of the key things for me is around the whole family approach, and Scottish Government are committing to that in part of the promise and part of the drug and alcohol framework. And I think in terms of link workers and then also in terms of good practice, some wraparound support where the whole family is involved, I think, is a key element and could be important as part of the link work that you mentioned earlier.
We'll go to our colleagues online and maybe get a response to Tess's questions there. If I come to Sharon first of all.
Yeah, so my current research is about how migrant essential workers have been affected by COVID. And one thing that would be really useful there is for link workers to be specifically dedicated for migrant communities. There's research from North America that they call it community navigators. And the idea is that the link worker would be someone from the community who helps sort of guide people towards health services. So it's culturally sensitive and appropriate, using the target language and specifically to put migrants in touch with the health services that they need.
Thank you. And I'll come to Karen now.
During COVID, a single access point model was piloted in an area of Dumfries and Galloway. And that was where it was that single point of contact. And from there, you were diverted to an appropriate agency. I think there's a kernel of a good idea in that. I think it would facilitate that no wrong door idea. However, it's operated by computer algorithms. So unless you're in the loop and your service is included in that single access point, the person would never get referred to you. But I think there's something that could really work and be quite innovative there. Somebody's not being passed a pillar to post, having to tell the story yet again. At that point of contact, they're sent to the right organisation straight off, whatever sector that should be. So I think the single access point, but to include a much wider sort of framework for who's on it.
Thank you very much. Can I move on to another colleague now? Sandesh, do you have a question or two?
Thank you, convener. It's a bit on Tessa's question, but what I want to focus on is sort of the inverse care law, where those who need help probably the most have the least access to it. And we can see that, Tony, we can see that with a lack of prison medics. We can see it in areas of poverty that have the least number of GPs available or dentists available for those people to access health. So my question is more focused upon healthcare and what we have done, anything good that's happened that we can see and point to and say, look, that's a good scheme, and how we can scale that up and allow people to have more access to healthcare.
Thank you. One of the things that comes to my mind when you were talking is around some of the effective initiatives happened in prisons. So the rollout of the COVID vaccine within prisons was a positive initiative and it was good take up. And where it fell down was when people returned to the communities. So that through care element and that community links and whatever is required is important. The bloodborne virus screening within prisons again was another positive initiative that we've seen work well within the prison establishment. So in terms of healthcare. But what strikes me is that often the third sector is playing a massive role in terms of supporting people with their health and reducing health inequalities. So I guess it relates to a point Karen made earlier that perhaps we need to be thinking a lot more about strategically about the role that third sector can play in partnership with different healthcare initiatives in order to have more positive outcomes for people involved.
Sadesh?
Just wondering if anyone else wants
anyone else to, want to come in. Add to that? No? Carry on.
Okay, so I suppose what we've seen is existing issues really being highlighted by COVID. And we're seeing quite clearly some of the real big fault lines that we have throughout Scotland. What do you think would be our number one priority to tackle in view of what COVID has shown us? And how would we actually be able to go about doing that?
Anyone in particular, or are you looking for someone? Richard will come in.
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, for unpaid carers, we need to see a return to the pre-pandemic level of support and services in the community. And I think it's over 70% of unpaid carers have yet to have a respite or a break as a result of the pandemic. And a lot of that comes down to because daycare services, other social care services are simply not back to the level they were pre-pandemic. Not that they were particularly sufficient at that point, but equally now, as a result, carers are struggling and they've just not been able to have a break. That needs to be a priority. And looking at things like self-directed support and how flexibilities promised during the pandemic were implemented in certain parts but not others. And some of those flexibilities could be, I think if implemented nationwide, could really support carers about how they spend a budget if they're eligible for getting one and being able to use that flexibly to get things like a break and to get support. So that for us would be a real priority, is that we need to focus on getting services back to pre-pandemic levels, so that not only do people need to get the support that they need, but it will allow carers to get breaks.
You and Sharon Wright wants to come in.
Thanks. I've got two number one priorities. So the number one priority, I think, is adequate income to tackle poverty. That's the best way to tackle health inequalities. But the number one health priority, I think, is mental health, because we've seen the evidence on the worsening of mental health during the pandemic. Is just it's a huge increase in mental health problems. How to go about doing that, I'm not so sure, but it's a huge problem, and mental health definitely needs to be tackled. In my current project on the impacts of COVID on minority ethnic groups, we found in our survey that it was people working in health and social care who had the worst mental health, and also people who are working in essential goods. So it might make sense to do a bit more research into who is worst affected in terms of mental health, and to target support specifically to those sectors. So to people working in health and social care and people working in essential goods. There was also an above average increase in mental health problems amongst those working in education. But that was, we think that was mainly a gender effect, that it was because that sector was dominated by women rather than the sector effect sort of separately.
Thank you. Can I come to Stephanie Callaghan?
Thank you, convener. My first question is to Dr. Wright. You spoke earlier on about lobbying Westminster to increase universal credit rates, and certainly that's not something that I disagree with. But what I'm just wondering about as well is the fundamental design flaws that we actually see in that system as well. So the conditionality, conditionality for employed and unemployed people. The long waiting periods, initially, at least 5 weeks when people are going without money, and the length and the severity of the sanctions that we have, which compared to the rest of the world are incredibly severe. So I was just wondering if you could comment on that. Thanks.
Yes, you're absolutely right that those are major problems with universal credit. So the conditionality is very problematic. So one of the problematic issues is that people are very scared of sanctions, even if they're not very likely to be sanctioned. And that fear runs really deep. So because the housing payment is in part of universal credit, people are really worried that if they miss an appointment just by 5 minutes, you know, if they're late for their appointment, they might end up losing their home. And that's, you know, you would think that's an irrational fear, but it's actually a rational fear, because that's how the system is designed, that these things are interconnected and people are really scared of losing them. So what's happened in recent years is that DWP have eased up on sanctioning. So the system is still extremely harsh by historic standards and in comparison to other countries. But what they've done internally is they have stopped applying sanctions as frequently as they did at the height of sanctioning, which was sort of 2013-2014. But the whole system, apart from they got rid of the longest sanction, which was for 3 years, but all of the other sanctions are still in place. So it would definitely be extremely welcome if you were able to lobby DWP to reduce the length of sanctions further and to protect people from being sanctioned. It's quite easy to trigger a sanction. The 5 week wait continues to be problematic. There's no evidence that there's any reason to design the system in that way. The rationale that DWP put forward is they say because universal credit is paid in arrears, that's why there's a 5 week wait. But they could just make a different policy design decision to pay people up front and then deal with it later if they weren't eligible for it for any reason. So the 5 week wait definitely should be changed because that is highly problematic. So the research I did in 2019-2020 for Joseph Rowntree Foundation in Glasgow showed that about half the people we interviewed applied for an advance payment and half didn't. So those who didn't have the advance really struggled during those 5 weeks. They found it extremely difficult to have money to eat. They had to rely on friends and family to get by with their basic survival. Those who did take the payment then had sort of stored up trouble for later because they had to repay it, which then meant that they didn't have enough money later. And then the other sort of side of conditionality, it's not just the being sanctioned or the fear of sanction, it's that continual pressure to work, which is especially difficult for people with long-term health conditions, people who are disabled, including many, many claimants who've got mental health problems. And what a lot of people didn't realise about universal credit when it was first released is that it's actually designed to treat people with mental health problems as if they don't have mental health problems. What we found in our Glasgow research was that people were waiting as much as a year for a work capability assessment. So they would be claiming universal credit and be subject to full conditionality. So they would be expected to look for a job or multiple jobs for 35 hours a week. And they could, in theory, discuss with their work coach a reduction in conditionality, but many people felt that they weren't able to do that. They felt disempowered. And even those who do request it are not guaranteed to get a reduction. So that that pressure to look for work was really intense. And then that fear of if you do the slightest thing wrong, you're not going to have any money to survive, also pushed people away from the system. So people who are eligible for universal credit don't necessarily claim it, or people might choose to stop claiming it because they're so put off by that intense pressure. So in my big research project about welfare conditionality, we spoke to people who had chosen to, instead of claiming, they had chosen to live in a car, for example, with their children, rather than claim universal credit. So that disincentive strategy is really powerful. And that's something that urgently needs to be addressed to make sure that people do get the support that they are entitled to. My current research with migrant essential workers showed that EU migrants were very unwilling to access universal credit. And some of those who tried were not able to access it because it's very difficult for people in that circumstance to claim. So it's working imperfectly. There are a lot of design flaws, but for those who are claiming, it would still be extremely helpful to reinstate that £20 uplift.
For a short supplementary, then I must move on.
Yeah, thank you. Kind of different question and a little bit wider there. What I'm wondering is how we actually put wellbeing at the centre of the approaches to all the different issues that we're hearing about around the table today, and whether perhaps there's a place for wellbeing plans for individuals themselves that they have power and control over, where they're looking at their own needs and prioritising their needs there, and then using that as their accessing different services right across the board there.
Supplementary in a completely new area, Stephanie, given that we've got 20 minutes left. But if we maybe could get a couple of our panellists to respond to that briefly before I move on to questions from Gillian Mackay. Richard.
Yeah, I can be very brief. Under the Carers Scotland Act, every carer should be entitled to either an adult carer support plan or a young carer statement. These should be, in part, wellbeing plans. They should be about identifying carer needs, having conversations about what they might need to support them in their caring role, signposting them for information and support, and if it's likely that they'll be eligible for further statutory support, then making sure that they get a carer's assessment.
Thank you.
And can I bring in Karen Lewis? Karen, I apologise to you. You wanted to respond to something that I think that was off the back of what Sandesh was asking about your top asks. Can I bring you back in before I move on to Gillian Mackay?
Yes, thank you for that. Although my response figures with other things as well that have followed since that. Basically, we did see during COVID that there was a flexibility around support. Obviously, we have the £20 uplift of universal credit. We had evictions were halted. There were other schemes, which shows that we can do things quickly when we need to do them. But my one ask would be that none of these things should be short term. We've seen the fallout with taking the £20 universal credit uplift back off. And I think this just feeds into what I talked about and Dr. Wright talked about, was that it builds in insecurity, anxiety and levels of stress in people who least need to be under those conditions because they're never quite sure if the rug's going to be pulled from under the feet. So I would say that my one ask would be whatever is developed and delivered to address poverty, as much as we're able within the confines of what funding we have available and what the legal framework is, we need to make sure it's not short term. We need to make sure that we're not building up an expectation that that's going to be there forever and then it's pulled away from people, or people plan their lives on the basis of A and then suddenly from nowhere they're on B. A lot of people we all presumably work with, certainly from the panel, are people who haven't got assets, they haven't got savings that can help them through a period that lots of us who have been in work maybe have got that. They haven't got access to credit. Lots of them haven't got families that they can rely on. So I do think that's a fundamental issue for me, that whatever we do needs to have longevity with it. And we're not getting people in this cycle of being back to square one constantly, because you can imagine how that erodes self-confidence, it erodes capacity, and it erodes people's health.
Talking about people effectively being in a precipice the whole time and been plunged in. So thank you for that description. Gillian.
Thanks, Convener, and apologies again for being late. There was an additional meeting of Bureau that I had to attend. I think for time, I'll stick my two questions together, if that's okay. Good morning panel, sorry. To what extent are health and care services taking a trauma-informed approach and what improvements need to be made? And the second question sort of links to that. We've heard this morning about interactions between income and poverty. In other sessions, we've heard about how disability, sexual orientation, gender identity, asylum status, justice experience, being a carer, and many other factors interact to present cumulative barriers. To what extent in each of your areas are health and care services equipped to take an intersectional, person-centred approach? And could I maybe just start with Tony?
Thank you. At the minute, there is prisons needs assessments undertaken. So the last prisoner needs assessment was done in 2007. And we urgently await the most up-to-date one, which I understand is currently underway, looking into the physical, mental health needs of prisoners, but also in terms of substance use. And we urgently await that so that we can design person-centred, trauma-informed services within prison. So we welcome that as a key opportunity going forward. And we would urge that any findings to that is clearly linked to anything that we think about in terms of health inequalities and the wider health and justice portfolio, of which there's many opportunities to join some of that up with the prison needs assessment stuff.
That's good, thank you. And just if anyone else...
I was
Who's next?
I mean, I think your point about intersectionality is really important. I mean, carers are more likely to be women, they're more likely to be in poverty, they're less likely to be in work, and more likely to be older. All of that combines to really contribute to the poorer health outcomes that they face when compared to non-carers. And I think actually what we really need to take is a real systematic approach to how do we address that, because you can't just fix one bit of it and then the rest will fall into place. You need to look at the whole system, and that includes everything from the health and social care system to transport, to the environment, to access to services, digital exclusion I mentioned, all of those things. We need a really public health approach when we're talking about how we tackle the needs of unpaid carers, and I don't see the possibility of that on the horizon at the moment, and I really hope that as a consequence of this inquiry is that some of these issues are addressed and that pressure is put on government and others to take that sort of systematic public health approach to some of these issues that we're talking about.
Okay, I'll come to Karen next.
I'm always speaking regarding people who come through the rent deposit scheme who, as I said earlier, often it's just poverty. I say just, they're in poverty, they haven't got other complex needs, so they've maybe not got other agency involvement. So I would say that I see very limited evidence of health and care taking a trauma approach. I think a lot of people go through services, certainly the people I talk to, who are not assessed on how this is affecting how your current situation and your experiential experiences have had a traumatic impact on your health. I'm not aware that that's asked. I'm not aware that that's investigated. And I think that that is something that trauma is there within the person. Services can assist a person, but we're not actually really digging down and finding out from a trauma approach on these things, certainly not in housing that I've observed.
And I'll come to Sharon last.
Thanks. In social security, there doesn't appear to be a trauma-informed approach, and rather than taking into account intersectionality or a person centred approach, the system, the UK-based system, seems to be driving trauma and reinforcing disadvantages and structural inequalities. So it would be a fantastic improvement if trauma was taken into account and if people were treated in a genuinely person-centred way. The DWP suggests that people's back to work plans, people's climate commitments are individually tailored, but all that means in practice, according to the people who we've spoken to, is that people will maybe have a reduction in the number of hours that they're expected to look for work or an adjustment in their conditionality. It's not genuinely person-centred in relation to anything to do with health or social care. And worse than that, it actually directly invalidates physical and mental health problems, because the system is taking too long to assess people's health and is disregarding medical evidence, people's medication, the opinion of specialists and GPs, doesn't inform the way that they're treated in terms of being pushed towards work. Well, at all, until they have a work capability assessment, and many people are not eligible even after work capability assessment, because particularly for mental health, they can't score enough points for that to make any difference to what's expected of them. So that would be a fantastic improvement if it could start to.
Okay. Thank you very much, Julian. Carol.
Thanks, Convener. So many of the points have been well made today, and a lot of my questions have been answered, but I'm particularly interested, obviously I take the points about lobbying and making sure we get the system change across the UK that is so desperately needed. Meantime, in Scotland, obviously we have responsibility here in the Scottish Parliament, so I'm interested to know what we can do in Scotland. So I'm hearing some of the things is we can maximise and use the benefits that are available to us here. We can look at system change here, and I'd be interested to know from the panel, particularly around carers, that we want people to know that they are entitled to these benefits, to these systems, to healthcare. How do you think we best do that in Scotland with the powers that we have here?
Well, I think you're right, and I think I've already mentioned that the carers allowance supplement, although welcome, could definitely be higher. There is a cost of living crisis at the moment. Scottish Government showed precedent during the pandemic where they doubled carers allowance supplement on at least two occasions, I think. We certainly would like to see that again this winter to support cost of living, which we know energy bills are going to go up again. But obviously, there's also the carers assistance consultation at the moment, and Scotland has a really good opportunity to to create a far better, far fairer and much more supportive carers benefit. And we would really urge them to consider to doing that. In terms of making sure that people are aware of what they're entitled to, that's huge. As I mentioned before, lots of carers don't recognise themselves as carers or aren't identified. We've done research that suggests it can take carers up to 2 years to realise that they are actually in a caring role. All in that time, they may well be getting support, whether it's social security support or whether it's support from social care services around short breaks and respite. So actually we must do more to try and raise the visibility of unpaid care and caring roles. And we must do more across all of our health and social care systems to proactively identify carers, approach them and support them to actually realise the support that they're entitled to and should be getting to help them in their caring role.
Carol?
Yeah, I just wondered from yourself if there was things you thought about how we make sure that the system understands that people are entitled to that healthcare.
Yeah, following on from much of what Richard's already highlighted, we know that the majority of people that we support at Families Outside are women and often are supporting a son or a partner within prisons. So I think more could be done in terms of the wraparound support within prisons and the justice arena to ensure that carers are identified and get access to the appropriate supports.
That's lovely. Thank you. Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you. Can I come to Evelyn? You have some questions.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. In evidence, we heard a lot from people who were worried about the cost of living crisis, how they were going to pay their bills, heating or eating generally. Obviously, a lot of people have got their heating off just now, but they're worried about winter. Do you think that Rishi Sunak's cost of living payments will help? And are people still in for a difficult winter? And I would like to put that to Dr. Wright, please.
Yes, the cost of living payment will help people, but I don't think it'll help people enough. So the shortfall is so great, and some people have enormous debts, you know, a history of debts that have built up over time, and the amount of money that people are getting through benefits and the extent of in-work poverty for those who are on low wages or working part-time, this means that there's an enormous gap between the amount of money people need and the amount of money people are getting. So it will help, but I don't think it'll help enough. And if I could just come back to that last question as well about what can we do in Scotland, I definitely support the proposal to increase the carers allowance supplement, to double it again. And I think a couple of ways that we could maximise take up would be via targeted adverts. So actually Facebook can be quite effective in this. They've got a targeted adverts function that could be used particularly to target carers, to target women in the particular demographic groups that we're most concerned about. And also radio adverts could be a good way to get to women who are of the sort of demographic that would need the carers allowance supplement. Thank
you. Would anyone else like to come in on Evelyn's question? Tony.
I just want to pick up on a quick point. There's a sort of robust evidence suggesting that the financial impacts on the family when someone goes to prison. Families Outside are currently involved in a piece of research at the minute, looking into more up-to-date evidence on that in terms of the financial impact. We know often when someone goes to prison, often that person was the sole breadwinner for the family. And one of the most important things our families want to do is to keep connected with the person in prison. and the increased cost of living and transport costs make that increasingly difficult. There is a help with prison visits, which people can access. It's means tested and it does sit with the UK government, so that that does present considerable challenges. And we have one family member in work poverty where they can't access this benefit. However, because they are employed, however, it doesn't take into account how far, for example, the family member may live from any given prison. So it increases social isolation and all the other things that we know impact that thereafter.
And that, of course, could impact on the breakdown of a family relationship, which would be particularly difficult when somebody's actually coming back into the community.
Absolutely.
Right, I wonder if... Richard, do you want to come back in?
I'd just add, in terms of the Chancellor's announcements, some carers will receive some of that support, whether they're on mean-tested benefits or pensioners. But we actually know that this, and we still haven't quite worked out the exact number, but a number of those carers will not get any of the additional support beyond what the rest of the population will get. And that gap is exactly why we think... carers allowance supplement should be doubled again this winter to make sure that carers particularly don't get disproportionately impacted again by the cost of living crisis.
And that comes back to that earlier comment we made about disproportionate effect of the increase in the cost of living, particularly in fuel. Sandesh wants to come in. There was something I did want to pick up on that Dr. Wright said at the very start, and I've written it down here, I just want a little bit more information, and I've heard it right. You said that people have been put off from claiming, and there's disincentives, to claim. We've heard that throughout this morning, and people are treated as if they were fit for work, perhaps, when they've got mental health problems. They might turn to survival crime or survival sex, I think you said there. So they're pushed... Could you expand on that, please? I have heard that right.
Yeah, you did hear that right. I know it's really upsetting, actually. This was a finding from a big research project that I did between 2013 and 2019 called Welfare Conditionality, and we looked at the impact of sanctions. What we found was it was a combination of things. So it was what was happening with the sanction system. It was also to do with benefit caps, the household benefit cap, the two-child limit, the freezing of the value of benefits. So all of those things combined to put people in really extremely difficult financial situations, much worse than would have been the case pre-2010. And we did interview people who had turned to extreme measures because they had no other alternative. So it was only a very small minority of the 481 people that we spoke to. But some people were forced to turn to survival crime and in a couple of situations, survival sex. So that was because they had no money and no way of getting any money. That they went to those extreme measures to try to get by. It's very, very distressing that people are doing things like that in times that shouldn't be happening.
Okay, thank you for clarifying that. And I guess with things like the cost of living crisis, that we might see more of that as people are plunged deeper into poverty. Sandesh, you have a question before we wrap up.
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to pick up on the question about the financial impact of going to prison. When you get released from prison, does that then mean that the job that you can get is of a much lower pay? And does it also mean that you're going to really struggle to get any job whatsoever?
Yes, I think we all, and it's well noted the struggles that many people with previous convictions have in terms of trying to reintegrate back into society and also be able to gain meaningful employment again. So, yes, I would agree that's an added barrier. But also just to pick up on the point that I made earlier about, meaningful relationships, access to care, all of that will ultimately have an impact on health. So, yeah, really important point.
Thank you. I want to thank all four of you for the time you spent, but also extend that thanks to the the many people who you brought to speak to us a couple of weeks ago, some of whom are in the gallery today, and it's nice to see you. Hopefully we'll be able to meet you after this meeting. Our next meeting on the 21st of June, the committee will continue taking evidence as part of our inquiry into health inequalities, but that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.